Day Street Books and Harper Audio present Knocking Myself Up, a memoir of my infertility by Michelle T. This is the author. Names and identifying details of many of the individuals discussed in this book have been changed to protect their privacy. The medical information contained herein reflects my own experience. I am not a doctor, and nothing you listen to here is intended to be, or should be, taken to be medical advice. For Tara Jepson. Introduction. Hello, this is your narrator, Michelle T. I'm about to bring you into my inner world during a period of time when that space was as wild, messy, hopeful, dizzy, tragic, terrifying, and open-hearted as any era I've ever lived. The process of deciding to have a baby and then going through with it is a rollicking ride, regardless of who you are and what your situation might be. You're setting out to conjure a life, and in the process, deeply unsettle your own. The you that you know yourself to be is about to be forever changed, not just by the introduction of a whole new person into the world, but by the decision itself, the places, literal and figurative, it takes you, the way it forces you to think differently about who you are and how you live. Every birth story is this, not just the dramatic climax of a last push and a first breath, but the story of a choice made, a dare accepted, a journey undertaken. The whole story of a birth begins with that decision to say yes, and the roller coaster that loop-de-loops you to the delivery table or at-home birthing pool or what have you, there is so much in it. All of life, every hope and fear, joy and sadness, the understanding of yourself as a mammal, an embodied animal, is in that story. Whether you've had kids or want to someday, or thank your lucky stars on the regs that you are child-free and therefore free, whether you're trapped in ambivalence about this big question, if you ended a pregnancy, are seeking to adopt, to foster, or plan to stick with cats, whether your body can nurture this kind of life or not, I hope you find in my story what we all look for in a book, a gaze into someone else's life that removes us temporarily from our own, that leaves us with new perspectives. I hope you laugh when it's funny and feel a smidge of my pain when it's not. For those of you who are contemplating this big life question, how cool if my own experience can help you weigh the pros and cons, or, if appropriate, inspire you to leap into the unknown. For those considering such a quandary who, like me, felt on the outside of traditional mom culture because you're queer or broke, unpartnered or uninsured, because you don't look like our culture's stereotype of the white, trim, middle-class, sexless mother, I really hope you find in my voice a kindred spirit. When I set out to try to knock myself up, I had pledged to not be precious about it. I would resist what the culture expects of people choosing to reproduce. I would resist the idea that this was the most important, most sacred thing I could ever do. At 40, I'd already done a lot, and many of those things were real accomplishments, as important as breeding. I wanted to keep potential motherhood in its proper place. Life-changing and magical, sure, but also incredibly common, one identity among many intersecting identities. One peak in a mountain range. Yes, the stakes become higher, but a sense of irreverence, deep, sometimes macabre, humor, a challenging eye, a gossipy tone, these are the things I wanted to reflect in this journey, to help humanize it, wrench it away from the contemporary culture of precious mommyhood into something more relatable and accessible. I truly wasn't sure I wanted a kid when I jumped off this cliff. I said yes more as a way to break out of what felt like a stultifying ambivalence, a dare to the universe to solve the issue for me, give me a baby or don't, so I could move past a question that weighed more heavily with each passing year. Somewhere in the multiverse is a me who didn't get pregnant, who instead moved to Paris and is currently bringing coffee and croissants to her throuple lovers, lounging in their big bed in a tiny room in a Pigalle walk-up. Somewhere else is a me who adopted. Somewhere else is a me who got knocked up naturally in my heterosexual youth. That me is a grandmother now. Our lives swirl with possibilities always, directions taken and refused. I set forth on this one and found turning back from it to be impossible. In this iteration of the multiverse, I'm mom, the kind of mom who got here through an odd yet common, queer and privileged path. I hope you enjoy the adventure. The Biological Clock, or Optimism. 1. A a cold summer night in San Francisco. When I started telling the people around me that I was going to get myself pregnant, they reacted in a variety of ways and not always as expected. My two best friends, with whom I have a very co-defendant relationship, were skeptical. "You can't just go and put the baby in the other room when you want to have sex," Tali said wryly, an apparent comment on my amorous lifestyle. Tali and I have been friends since the 90s, when we were both drunken poets slurring into the mic at open mic events. Now that we were older and sober, Tali's approach to life had become more grounded and cautious, and she was unafraid to offer her strong opinions, peppered as they were with a dark and honest humor. I was uncertain how to respond to my dear friend's read. Of course I understood that the baby would have to come before my libido, but really, why couldn't I tuck the baby in the other room when I wanted to have sex? That sounded reasonable. Tali tried another angle. "You like to take off and go to Paris." I was becoming a bit enchanted with my life as seen through my friend's eyes. Who was this jet-setting tart? But I hadn't been to Paris in years, and anyway, wouldn't I want to take my little bohemian baby traveling abroad? Wouldn't I want to teach them French by immersion in the cafes of the Bastille? In fact, maybe I would want to actually give birth in Paris, gifting my bébé with dual citizenship in an elegant, socialist country and treating myself to a free socialist hospital birth. Tali saw that her warnings were having the opposite effect and sighed in resignation, offering one more deterrent. "But you love your life." This made me pause. I do love my life, I thought to myself. I lived by myself in a spacious San Francisco apartment I could miraculously afford with the income I patched together running a literary nonprofit, writing books and essays, and reading tarot cards. My apartment building was old and gray, but in a dignified way, like Iris Apfel. The staircase had a polished wood banister, and the lobby was lined with mirrors so you could get your last looks in before you pushed open a heavy glass door and went out onto the wind tunnel that is Page Street. Landing there seemed like a miracle in and of itself, not least because my inbred money scarcity almost pushed me to turn my back on it. The fact that the rent was so seriously under market value, this during the legendary San Francisco era of the tech bro, did not even register to me. All I saw was that it was more money than I'd ever spent on housing, and I balked, fear of having to come up with more money per month setting my stomach churning. Thankfully, some friends who, while they may be similarly blinded by their own survival fears, can at least see it plain and clear when manifesting in another. That entire apartment literally costs $200 more a month than what you're paying to live in a converted living room in a flat with 20-somethings who keep mistaking their cocaine panic for heart attacks and calling the fire department, Tali lectured sternly. You should move. San Francisco is a city of neighborhoods, but this latest spot I found myself in, my charmed apartment, seemed to be in a liminal space. I'd lived in a few different San Francisco neighborhoods, mostly the Mission, which I watched go from a neighborhood of Latinx families, Salvadoran restaurants, street hookers, and dykes, to a neighborhood of white tech workers, pastry shops selling deconstructed confections, electric scooters, and yoga moms. For years, I lived in North Beach, worried that the throngs of tourists would drive me mad, but I was ultimately delighted to be residing in a spot that so many people from all over the world wanted to visit. The air smelled like rosemary focaccia, and my local bookstore was City Lights, where the elderly Lawrence Ferlinghetti, RIP, was often in residence being interviewed by European film crews. I'd also lived in Bernal Heights, both at the foggy top of the hill where condensation would drift beneath the back door and fill the kitchen with clouds, and at the bottom where the jagged sing-song of drunkards doing karaoke at naps provided a quirky soundtrack to my life. My new neighborhood was a no-man's land that wasn't quite the grungy Lower Haight and wasn't quite Hayes Valley. It was a lovely spot that allowed me to walk most anywhere or hop on a lumbering orange bus if it was rainy or I was lazy. After decades cohabitating with various roommates, I relished the luxury of my own apartment. Nobody left passive-aggressive notes for me if I didn't clean up my mess swiftly enough. No having to nag people for their portion of the electric bill. No facing another human in the kitchen before I'd had my first cup of coffee. Life was pretty blissful, and when I thought about my humble beginnings, across the country in a rundown New England town, my life felt like a freaking fairy tale. which was exactly why I wanted to bring a little creature into it. From where I stood, deep in my 40th year on Earth, my remaining eggs hobbling down my fallopian tubes each month, tennis balls wedged onto their walkers, it seemed like having a kid was the only adventure I hadn't undertaken. My friend Mel's face crumpled in despair when I told them. "Your work," they moaned, mourning all the books I would not write. They told me all about the depressing life of their girlfriend's sister, a single mother. Everyone, it seemed, had stories of miserable single mothers, and they all wanted to share them with me. And yet, all the moms I knew were totally psyched and encouraging of my steps toward Babyville. My AA sponsor, deeply in love with her adopted son, urged me on, suggesting I have an affair while traveling. In their 30s, while selling weed, my friend Belle accidentally got knocked up by their bipolar boyfriend and kept the baby. Now they have a second kid and live an inspiring life in Hollywood working on television projects, sans bipolar boyfriend. They racked their brain for sperm donors, briefly offering up their husband, but then realized they'd be upset if my baby wound up better than theirs. Esther, another writer who kept her accidental pregnancy, also thought it was a great idea. We remembered sitting backstage with Exene Cervenka at a poetry reading, how she urged us to have a kid someday. "It makes you more psychic," she promised, a nice perk. My sister Madeline, who not only had a 3-year-old daughter, but who knows me better than anyone, my strengths and weaknesses, how I am both diligent and a space cadet, began teaching me how to track my ovulation cycle. My mother, a lovable nervous wreck who was often frightened of my life choices, sex work, walking through the East Village alone past midnight, attending Mayan sweat lodges in the Mexican jungle, surprised me by offering advice on turkey basters. How did she know about this classic lesbian method of insemination? Floating on their encouragement, it seemed that I was, with a lingering hint of trepidation, really pursuing this. With my mom on board, how could even my most reticent friends not come around? Tally, who supports her writing habit by working in a co-op grocery store, relented. "Well, I can get you 20% off your prenatal vitamins. And tell your mom we have really high-quality glass turkey basters." Although my friend's anti-baby fears gave me the opportunity to try out my pro-baby arguments, the truth was, the dare to depart on this wild new direction existed in my body alongside self-doubt, the economic scarcity issues that were my birthright, and basic terror of the unknown. My inner yes and no merged into a gray fog of ambivalence. I wanted to know, with a bright, clear, 100% assurance that yes, a child was totally my destiny and would make my life complete, or no, I was simply not cut out for motherhood, what with my head for art and my bod for sin and my income that fluctuated like a PMS mood swing. Throughout my 20s, I thought of pregnancy the same way I thought of any STD, but with a dose of the movie Alien. Something foreign gestates inside you, siphoning your nutrients, changing your behaviors, as many parasites do, before finally clawing its way out, leaving you maimed and possibly even dead. Many acquaintances were disturbed by this understanding of babies as invasive monsters and not, you know, cute. Then, at 27, I read Ariel Gore's book, The Hip Mama Survival Guide, and suddenly, pregnancy seemed sort of cool, like some sort of wild art project. Ariel's book was the first thing I had ever read that gave me, poor, queer, weird, permission to bring a kid into the world. I don't know if the book triggered something biological or if it was the right time, right place, but suddenly, babies didn't seem like the grotesque hobgoblins I'd feared them to be. In fact, I began craving the feeling of being pregnant. What is this? I marveled. How could my body crave something it had never known? This new sensation surged briefly into an obsession before it receded, leaving me different. The thought of having a kid was no longer repulsive. For the next decade, I wobbled back and forth, wondering if a child was something I wanted. It was frustrating not to know. I had a long-term relationship with someone who absolutely did not want a baby, who got worked into a frenzy if the topic was introduced even speculatively, causing me to shelve it. Later, I dated people who did want children, but they tended to suffer from borderline personality disorder or some not otherwise specified psychological malaise. It seemed that if I had a healthy partner who wanted a baby, then maybe I would want a baby too. I began to lament the impossibility of getting accidentally knocked up. When I was younger, I was relieved that the people I dated, women, trans men, and gender nonconforming people assigned female at birth, could not get me pregnant. What a great thing not to have to worry about. Now I was regretful that I couldn't allow a broken condom to make the decision for me. All of this brings me to a cold summer night in San Francisco, when I sat at my vintage kitchen table, a cheery buttercup yellow formica, my laptop displaying what appeared to be a legit source detailing how tragic my 40-year-old eggs were. Horrifyingly, I learned, your eggs are best during the fragile era of your late teens / early 20s. By the time you're 40...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.